Recording. That's a little bit wobbly.
I am recording. Right. Da 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 da.
Alright, should we do the inaugural?
Right, good luck.
Alright. One, two, three.
Hey, I think that was pretty good.
Yeah, that wasn't bad. Okay, hi guys, and welcome to the show. And today, once again, it's that time. Oh, can't I say this every? I say it's that time of the month.
Yeah, it sounds a little weird. You should keep that in.
Okay, hi guys, and welcome to the show. And today, once again, I want to say the same thing. What can we say?
Well, how about you don't make it that it's expected?
Right.
Yeah,
it's
just
that
say,
monthly.
Another monthly
it's
visit.
It's our monthly show. Yeah, another monthly visit.
Yeah.
By my good friend Marc at Long Island Watch. How are you, sir?
I am doing terrific. How are you?
Good. Very well, thank you. Very well. How's the family?
Good.
And how's the thumb? Because
last time you
cut it off.
Is,
they put it back on.
It's actually, I'll tell you, the human body is an amazing thing. Totally amazing. I mean, it's a little scar tissue, a little tender still, but
right.
I can't believe it. So cool.
And what is, good, I'm glad
you're
better.
Oh, are you looking at my Instagram counter?
Yeah.
We didn't even talk about that.
And how does that work then?
So
how's that
is hooked into Wi-Fi. And right. It's made by a company called, it's a horrible name, Smirl, S-M-I-I-R-L. Not
Smirl.
Endorsing it or anything. It popped up on my Instagram feed. It's a mechanical flip counter. And it counts your real-time Instagram followers. And, you know, I can use a phone, obviously, to look at the number of followers. But I thought this was so cool. It's a mechanical representation. And it kind of really resonated with me. So it
I
updates.
Like it. So how does it know when to
you set
over?
It. So it got annoying. It can go real time, like every 10 seconds. Which
right.
Not that I get a new follower every 10 seconds, but, you know, every few minutes a new follower pops in. But you can set it to go at intervals. So mine goes every 12 hours or so. So it's like 8 in the morning and 8 at night. It.
But what happens when you get to 100,000?
Well, so they sell it in... It's a good question. Hopefully your viewers can get me there.
By the way, I mean, like I need to introduce Marc.
Guys,
subscribe to Marc's channel and his Instagram now.
So they make a 5 counter, a 5-digit and a 7-digit. I thought the 7-digit was too forward of me to get. So I think I'll get the 5, and if I run into an overflow situation, I will.
Yeah.
I'll get the 7. So that's
you
what,
are
that's,
great.
And people say that my background's a little dry, so this is kind of it's my
right.
new it's my new little.
You
decoration.
Say I like it. It yeah, nice.
It's nice.
Very nice.
Yes.
Cool. So we're gonna do pet peeves.
Yes.
Today.
Oh, before we do, you.
Oh, yes.
Remember
I was going to ask you. You need to confess.
There's nothing to confess to. So our last video, okay, one of my all-time best Seikos was the snowflake. And in that video, I had said to you, I don't own a spring drive. But there was a watch that came out recently from Seiko, and I really liked it. Well, about a week later, I placed some texts to some people high at Seiko, and lo and behold, 400 piece limited edition run, full titanium spring drive, GMT power reserve, SNR049, I think. I was able to get one, so it came, and it's been in my wrist ever since.
Caspita,
nice.
So just the one today?
No, come on. Marathon released a anthracite bracelet for their G-SAR, so I've been wearing this almost like a durability test for now. It's been over 2 weeks, and the thing is not a scratch on it. Really clean.
Is that the 36?
No, this
millimeters?
Is actually a 41.
The
people get confused
size,
on
right.
size. This is the full size. The 36, or what they call the midsize, is in my opinion super small. I like the 41 for me, 6 3/4 inch wrist. So, but yes, yeah, so
very,
how about
nice.
You? What are you doing?
I'm complete opposite of both of yours. I'm doing a, I'll show you first.
Yeah, no problem.
A classic 1950s Seamaster, solid gold.
Very nice.
No date, kind of almost explorer-esque
okay.
dial.
Okay.
But this, This is the 500 caliber automatic that I love this era of Amiga. It's just before the trilogy came out.
Right.
You know, so like this was before the Seamaster became a proper diver, you know.
That's really nice. So, classic.
Yeah, it's just, I love it. I scratched the, I dropped something behind the cupboard in the kitchen.
And you went to go grab it.
Yeah, and I scratched up the, I had to order Polywatch, but yeah. I'll do a tutorial.
Oh, it's, that stuff's amazing. It works great. It works great.
Yeah. So that, anyway, right, should we, because we better crack on with this.
Cause oh,
this
yeah,
is
yeah. It's gonna be a
this
long
is going to take.
No, I don't want to spend all day doing this.
Yeah, yeah. Grab your popcorn, a couple of drinks. I'm sipping tea. My voice is a bit, I apologize if it's a bit Barry White.
I got today, water. But,
yeah, I don't know why I woke up with a sore throat. Mm. So I got some lovely tea. So there we go. How British, right? now, is this in descending order?
Well, I have two lists. We're doing pet peeves, right?
So yeah, I've got about 20 pet peeves that I'm going to read at the end.
Oh, okay, got it. Extras. So yeah, you said we're doing pet peeves today, so I figured I'd make it a little bit fun, and I'm going to do the top five I think that my customers have, and
nice.
then my own five.
Perfect.
So a little bit of both.
Cool. Okay. Would you like to go first?
I can if you'd like me to.
Are you going to do customers?
I'll do customers first. So my number one customer pet peeve is when they have watches that don't hack, which means when you pull out the crown to set the time, the seconds hand stops. It's a crazy pet peeve, but I'm like, why do you care? Because even the finest automatic watch is going to be off by a few seconds after the first day. So I don't understand the whole need for hacking. I know it bugs people to no end. I guess Miyota finally answered the call. Their 821A movement, they actually added, it was a historically hand-winding, non-hacking movement. They just added hacking to it recently. So I guess people are listening and know that you like your hacking. So hacking tends to be a big one with my customers.
I kind of get it. But at the end of the day, you're right. It's you know, I don't really check the accuracy of my watches that much, you know.
And
unless you're a commando about to storm an enemy position in World War II,
right.
Like, you know, it's really not that important. I mean, if you're minutes ahead or minutes behind, then yeah, sure, you know.
But hacking is for that 2-second accuracy, you know, from the days when you used to call the phone number to get the real time.
Right.
But at the beep, it'll be 1202.
Does it still do that? I haven't actually owned a real phone for... Like a landline, right?
Well, I'm sure you can call it from a cell number. It was just like, it was like the NIST, you know, like the national phone, national time. I don't know if that still exists.
I wonder, question for...
Yeah, question for people watching.
Yeah, and half the audience probably won't even know what a landline is. Okay, now I wrote mine on my phone. This is from a YouTuber's perspective kind of thing.
Oh, okay, good.
It's kind of changing now. Like, Oris kind of reached out to me recently, which I'll tell you about in a moment. But it's only the fashion watch brands, aggressively reach out to me to review.
Oh, okay.
And I always turn them down because it's like, it's not really
not
what my audience, it's not my thing. And to be honest, I send them an email, and now I don't really bother because it's just, it's companies that they hire.
Right.
It's like
PR marketing, it's marketing companies.
Yeah.
Sure.
I email back and I say, I would love to, but you are aware I'm going to be, you know, it's going to be an, I'm going to have positives and negatives. And, you know, I don't really want to do that.
Right.
And I just wish, my pet peeve is I wish the real watch companies would reach out to me. And I know why, and we'll get into it in a later point about watch journalism. This is probably going to be a very controversial video, but I don't care. And some brands don't even, I have to chase them down, and they don't even lend out watches for review. And I don't ask for anything. I'm not interested in keeping the watch. I just need the watch.
Right.
To review.
Send it back.
And I'll send it back.
Yeah.
Why is it only fashion watch brands that are really engaging with social media? Oris did lend me the new Aquis with the in-house movement,
mm-hmm.
and they emailed me, and it was great. That's how it should be.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. There, because the fashion brands are the ones that unfortunately have the brains and the marketing brains. A lot of these established companies that you're referring to, these Swiss companies, it's still run by very old mindsets.
Yeah.
And you know, you can tell by a lot of the brands that you may want to review their stuff. Go to their YouTube accounts and look at how many subscribers they have. It's sad. It's actually sad. Some of them have like startup accounts, like 10,000 or 20,000. Right. Where a company like Rolex, they got the following. They engage. They may not engage with vloggers, but they engage the audience. I think a lot of these companies are still stuck in the mud.
Yeah, if I added up all the fashion brands and probably tried to calculate how much money they've offered me,
right?
And that's the other thing. I'm not interested. I don't. Right. You could. There's nothing. Well, I mean, obviously, if they're gonna pay me some ludicrous amount, and then I'll be like, bye, no more YouTube, bye. I'm chilling on an island. But that's ridiculous. But I wouldn't do that to my audience. And also, you know, I could have bought a Lange now, but
right.
Nobody will watch my channel because right. You know I'm not. It's
a sellout.
I'm not gonna do that.
I get it.
It just still pees me off. You know.
Yeah.
There we go. Anyway.
Yeah.
This is gonna turn out to one of these rant things.
Yeah, it is because I have more. I can say more about that, but I'm gonna keep my mouth shut.
All right. Go for it.
So next peeve would be secondhand registration on quartz watches. The secondhand ticks.
Yeah.
And if it doesn't hit the hash marks 360 degrees around, that bothers the crap out of a lot of people. And, you know, from an engineer's perspective, I look at it and there are some brands that are good at it. Citizen is good at it. But a lot of brands, they're just simply not investing enough money. It's too expensive to get perfection out of this. You know, it's the movement, it's the printing on the dial has to be perfect, it's the seconds hand has to be perfect, and then it's the installation of the dial on the movement has to be perfect, and then it's the installation of the hand onto the movement has to be perfect.
And this is usually on a very affordable entry level, right?
Your quartz watches. I would say,
because I've noticed Timex.
Once you hit like marathon level, like their quartz, you know, the quartz watch like this, they get to be really good at it, and it gets to be fairly accurate. But your $100-$300 quartz watches, the seconds hand maybe for half the dial it's a quarter past the second, and then for the rest of the sweep around the dial it might be on, or it might be halfway in between or whatever, but I know it bothers the crap out of people. They want to see perfection.
I can understand that. I can understand both.
I understand both
sides of the story.
Unfortunately, I'm an engineer, so it kind of I feel bad for the I'm wearing my Cooper Union shirt.
Oh yeah,
today.
We didn't do a t-shirt check.
Yeah, so I went to the Cooper Union Engineering School, and I see the engineering side, and I'm like, I get how hard this is to do, so I kind of feel bad for these folks.
Yeah, fair enough. Actually, that kind of segues nicely into my next one, is taking watches way too seriously.
Okay.
You know, and I think it's more about the social media interaction and like people who get into arguments and
right.
Like, I don't really frequent forums because it just
too
everything
much.
Everything devolves into an argument, and I understand people have different tastes, and it starts off like, oh, Omega's better than Rolex, you know. And then it just escalates, and because look, social media, there's a lot of tribalism, there's this kind of venting because it's anonymous.
It's not anonymity, yeah.
Don't take it so seriously, you know. It's like, it's not everything. It's not life or death.
It's a watch.
Yeah, it's a watch. Yeah, don't. I mean, I've done so many videos ranting about snobbery and all this stuff, and it's just like, don't take it so seriously. Just relax. You know, we all like the same thing.
We're all here to better the, you want to call it a hobby, we're here to better the hobby.
Yeah.
Why can't we all just get along, to use a famous line?
Yes. Exactly.
I agree. Agreed.
Yeah, nice. Your turn.
My turn. So that I hear from my customers, why doesn't it have a sapphire crystal? That one of the, it's a big one. You know, for that amount of money, I should be getting Sapphire, which, again, I understand, but I also see the, well, now that I'm, you know, now that I'm making watches or have my own brand, I see the cost involved, and Sapphire is pricey to add in. You know, so, you know, if I could see why if a $500 Seiko is still sporting hard Lex, I kind of understand. But a lot of these $200 and $300 watches, yeah, they probably should be sporting a Sapphire and not a mineral. But I guess it comes down to, like you had mentioned before, you reached your hand behind to get something. If it would have been a mineral crystal watch, it probably wouldn't have scratched at all. But I don't know what people are doing with their watches such that their mineral crystals get so scratched. They look like they went through World War II. Because I have a lot of mineral crystal watches. I guess I have a lot of watches, but I have a lot of Hardlex crystal watches, mineral crystal watches, and it's like none of them are scratched. I guess I'm just not rough enough with my hands, but I always hear that. Like, oh, I has to be Sapphire. I need Sapphire. And, you know, you don't always get that.
Yeah, the force required to really smash a watch like that, it's probably gonna hurt you.
Yes. Yeah,
you know, so I get it, and actually that will tie into a point that will come later about, you know, the they're just not aware of the costs involved and
that's
the
true.
The other perspective,
right?
This is gonna ruffle some feathers, but watch dealers are the new used car salesmen. Right. And what I mean by that is I should preface this by highlighting a good watch seller who I'm talking to right now.
Oh, God. Right? I was like, well, I wonder who he's going to say.
Yeah. No, but you, I mean, I've known you ever since from the very early days of the channel. The fact that I still talk to you, that we're friends is not only a testament to your character, but it's because you're somebody reputable and I was a customer first.
Right.
I would never recommend anybody that wasn't, you know, I have to stand behind.
Of course.
You know, but I've seen so many dodgy watch dealers, especially with used watches, vintage watches. Mm-hmm. It's a minefield and it takes decades and decades of experience and learning. And still people can make mistakes. Nobody's perfect. You know?
Right.
We're all fallible. These kind of overnight, and now you see vloggers becoming dealers and stuff, and it's like, no, just, you know, it's a recipe for disaster.
So I will then say what I was going to say before.
Right, yeah.
when you were talking about marketing and how only the fashion brands reach out to you. I was going to say, if you want the big brands to reach out to you, you just need to open a store. And then start selling the watches and then reviewing them and selling them. And then apparently they will start to talk to you.
Oh, really?
Because this is what they want. They want a face and they want reviews, but they don't necessarily want to pay for them.
Yeah, this goes into another point. Another pet peeve of mine is established watch brands that refuse to lend in watches.
Okay.
And I know why it is. It's because they're scared of the negative section.
They're scared of course.
They don't want any criticism. Well, then I'm not going to review your watch. How am I going to recommend your brand if you won't even let me review it?
Because you're honest with it.
Yeah, you can't be honest with it.
Right.
I mean, I could. Should I name brands?
Oh, it's up to you.
No,
I'm not going to name. I'm not naming names, and I will keep a neutral expression.
Right, but okay. So there's a very popular dive watch, and very nice, and I like them, and I've reached out to them, but they refuse to be reviewed.
Right,
you know, I'm not going to recommend you. It's a shame because they're great history, great watch. You know, that scared that I'm going to say, oh, the lug is too long, or the strap could be better.
I might change one of my future peeves now that we're talking about this. But
okay.
We'll see you later.
Okay.
So my next one that from customers. And this one is kind of funny. Even with, they can't get a good fit on a bracelet watch, even with a three position micro adjust. They just can't get the right fit. And I'm thinking, oh, this one's got micro, it's in the ratchet, it's in the clasp. But if you have like eighth inch increments, how do you not, you know what I mean? How do you not find your sweet spot? They're like, oh, one notch is too tight and one notch is too loose. I need a half link. I mean, then you start going through all these geometric configurations where you can to attain any fit you want. I think it's just funny that people say, I can't find it. I can't get the bracelet to fit me correctly. I need a new clasp or something.
Yeah.
Like, wow.
By the way, I didn't say congrats on the on that Seiko.
Oh, that's okay. It's you can gorgeous. Say congrats. It is.
Yeah.
It's really nice. I love it.
I bet you're chuffed with it.
I am. I've been wearing it every day.
Yeah.
I've been wearing it every day. I love it. I love it.
Nice.
I sized it up. It is pins and collars.
Right, of course, yeah.
I guess it's titanium, but yeah. I just scratched the clasp already like an idiot. But other than that, actually, it is fairly... I scratched it on a lamp. I was hooking up a new lamp, and I went, oh, and I heard it.
Yeah.
And it was hard. But no, it's remarkably still, after a few weeks, no scratches, just that one. So, no.
To go back to your point, do you think it's because of a temperature change or people get increase in size and decrease in size throughout the
definitely,
day?
Definitely, obviously, during the summer, you need a little, that's where ratcheting clasps are great. You need a little more, and during the winter, your wrist shrinks. Even if you're an indoor person all the time, it doesn't matter. It's still perceived temperature is a lot colder, but it tends to be the same. Like, if one person can't find a good fit, they pretty much can't find a good fit with anything unless they've got, like, 20 micro positions that they can play with.
Right.
And I think that also goes into, you know, you just put it on and wear it and enjoy it.
Yeah.
And don't worry about everything else.
Right. Fair enough. So my next one is no free press in the watch world. Wait, these are my notes. Maybe I shouldn't read these out. Sorry. Yeah, so the death of watch journalism in the traditional sense, like printed media.
Absolutely.
I was shocked to know that even just mentions and things how the brands control these magazines and stuff. And it horrified me really, and completely it was the first nail in the coffin, so to speak, and this is the reason why now I don't follow any of the big. There's a few still really good ones, which I'm sure you know who they are. Most of them I can't read because I just can't trust them in that capacity. And I feel as the traditional magazines have kind of died, we are seeing beautiful little blogs of true enthusiasts.
Independence.
Yeah,
independence, sure.
So there's a great guy, glycentennial.com, right? I've mentioned him before. He's obsessed with the Glycine Airman and the Combat Sub, right?
Okay.
You read his articles, he's done huge deep dives on the history and but it's from passion because he loves that watch.
Right.
He's not making a living out of it.
Right, I was just going to say that. He's not making a living out of it. If you're not making a living out of it, you speak your mind and you do what you want to do. But once your, you know, finances come into it, well then, if, I'm not going to say this, let's say Hamilton. I don't care who it is. It doesn't make a difference. Let's say Hamilton says, oh, you know, we'll give you, you know, $3,000 to write a good review about this watch. And if you're passionate, you would say, well, I can't, in my right mind. I'm not saying they do that. I have no idea. I'm just kind of thinking right out of my head. But being their Swatch Group brand, they probably do. But you know, that's kind of where you lose.
Yeah.
Again, this is, I definitely got to maybe change one of my peeves later. You lose honesty in journalism, 100%.
Absolutely. And for those of you wondering, this is another reason why Well, last year was different because I got, you know, I got help. But this year I'm back to doing YouTube part time because it's the only way to sustain myself. I have a life outside of YouTube, right? So, to remain truly independent.
Well, yeah, I mean, I'll give people credit that make a living off of YouTube. I mean, you know, for me, it's just whatever, you know, revenue it throws off is purely secondary.
Yeah.
But month to month, revenues go like this. It's crazy.
Yeah.
How the hell do people live on this?
I'm editing, I'm freelance, I'm consulting, I'm doing so much.
Doing other stuff.
But it's good because, like, for example, I reviewed a Cuervo y Sobrino watch. I loved it.
The cigar company.
A great watch. You know, they actually reached out to me. Beautiful little Landeron based chronograph, gorgeous. Mm-hmm. And now I'm, you know, considering one. And it's not like a viral video. I did it out of because I was curious. I enjoyed the watch. It was by no means perfect, you know.
Right.
You know, overpriced, if you want to know. It was way overpriced, but that's how a review should be done.
Right. I agree.
So anyway.
I agree. All right, let's go to my last one from customers. Let's see. Oh, accuracy. Accuracy of automatic wristwatches. you know, people, you know, if you get a Seiko and it's 2 seconds a day and that's your only watch and that's great, but then you buy another Seiko, Orient, whatever else it is, and it's 8 seconds a day, you've been spoiled and you think that 8 seconds a day is horrendous. When in truth, +6 to -4 is chronometer accuracy. And, you know, Orient puts in their books +25, -15. Seiko, when pushed, will say 45 seconds for 4R36. Generally much better, but people really, I find, again, they hang their hat on accuracy. And it almost goes hand in hand with hacking that I mentioned before.
Yeah.
Yeah, my opinion is if you have to adjust the watch 1 minute when you wake up, you know, every other day or every third day, not really the end of the world. And again, no. I'm not the kind of person that's wearing the same watch every day except except right now. Yeah. But the spring drive is kind of more quartz. Well, I don't want to get into that right now.
Yeah.
But the accuracy is amazing. But I think it's funny that people hone in, I guess the uninitiated, when I explain to them that a $10 Timex will be more accurate than a $6,000 Rolex, they don't understand it, don't believe it, and then it's, why would you even buy one of these more expensive watches if they're not accurate? So I guess a little bit uninitiated, but again, I think that people do get hung up around the accuracy of their automatics just a little bit too much.
Back to what I was saying earlier about, you know, taking watches too seriously. It's really not that serious. Well, this is like what you were saying. When people complain about the cost of a watch, it's a lack of awareness, because I kind of was a little bit guilty of this back in the day when I first started. But then I visited watch factories.
Yeah, and you see what they do.
Yeah, from start to finish. And I'm talking, you know, I've been to high-end independents, to complete in-house manufacturers, to entry-level kind of tool watch makers, right?
Right.
And doesn't matter if you're putting an ETA in it or you're making the hairspring from scratch, right? People love to complain about the price. It's the number one comment I get on almost every single watch. Oh, that's nice, but it's a bit expensive.
It should be $400.
It should be like they should work for free. Like the electricity is free, the materials, the wages, the tax, the legalities, marketing. It's all free.
You're right.
You have to remember this, and God forbid they make a profit. You know, you think they're doing it for fun?
Right. You know? Exactly. Yeah, it's, you know, I get a kick out of people that will say that, you know, if you melt down, a great example is Rolex. If you melt down a Rolex to its constituent parts, it's worth whatever it's worth, $300 or $400 in raw materials. You know, how can you justify getting $6,000 for it? Well, I say you take those raw materials and you do it all yourself, and you figure out how to refine the steel and machine it and polish it. And,
right.
As you said, make a hairspring, like all the crazy stuff they do. It's all very expensive, and it all goes in. As you said, they're entitled to make money. The dealer is entitled to make money, and you know. Then it also depends how they're set up. Are they, you know, I'm in a different situation in some brands because it goes from manufacturer to me. So there's not, I hate to use the term middleman, but if there's a middleman, I guess it's me. But there's, you eliminate a couple of levels of distribution, and that takes money out of it. But there's always people along the way that have to make money, whether it's the person putting it together or it's the person selling it.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And now I'm now on to mine.
My personal ones.
I'm going to fold my paper now so I don't look at the other ones, because I had too many. So there we go. So my number one. So now this is coming from both as, you know, as a person, in my personal opinion, and also as a seller. And I'm looking at you, Orient. odd size lugs.
Yes.
Bambino, 21 millimeters.
Amen to
that. Why? There's such an ecosystem built around parts compatibility. And nobody makes, well, it's not nobody. Hirsch makes 21 millimeter straps. They sell a couple of them. But why 21? Would it kill you to machine away an extra 39,000s of material to make it a 22? Yeah. No one's going to really notice. And I think we've discussed this before.
Yeah, we have.
Whatever,
yeah.
Whoever the designer is, the golden ratio wasn't right or something.
Yeah,
but
yeah, yeah.
It's just like, why? You're killing. You could sell so much more.
Mm.
You know, if you would just make it. Some people don't buy this stuff because they go, "Oh, I've got, a whole draw load of 22 millimeter straps, but I can't use them, so I'm not going to buy the watch." Mm. So odd size lugs.
Absolutely.
It was okay 50 years ago when 19 millimeter was big, but we're not there anymore. 18s, 20s, 22s.
Yeah, and I think it's especially bad when it's like a dress watch, and because if it's a diver, right?
You can
stuff a Perlon or a NATO in there, right?
Right, you could do something nylon that it kind of has a little give, or a rubber that has some give to it. But leather, it's either going to knock around or you're going to squish the crap out of it.
And it never looks good unless it's precise. Yeah.
You're correct.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's a good one. Well, number seven for me is talking trash about a watch you've never tried on or experienced in person.
Sure.
It sounds so simple, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But again, going back to, and this is from, a reviewer perspective. But,
right.
So, that watch is crap.
Yeah.
Oh, how long have you owned it?
I don't. I read all about it. I read it on the internet.
It's like, have you tried it? Have you worn it? Like, my perceptions of watches change so much. The Rolex Explorer. Mm-hmm. I always thought it was boring.
Right.
Always. And then a friend of mine lent me one, and I was like, this is great.
Right.
You know, so perceptions can change. And I just, it goes, again, goes way back to the first point of people venting.
Right.
You know, it's like the toxicity of their life
mm-hmm.
bleeding into watches.
Right, exactly, exactly. So now this is definitely as a seller. So people might not get this. Manufacturers that undersell their vendors. So 20 years ago, this was never an issue. But now in the digital age, a lot of the manufacturers have their own websites that they sell on. So they'll sell to stores like myself to resell,
mm-hmm.
or they sell direct to customer. And sometimes, all of a sudden, I'll get an email from someone that says, hey, model XYZ is available direct from the manufacturer for less than you're selling it for. Right. And I'm like, well, they tell me I'm not allowed to sell it that low. There's something called minimum advertised price, which is something that I sign saying I won't sell this. I won't advertise. I can't say sell. I won't advertise this watch for less than $250. I was like, well, but they've got it for $225. I'm like, what the hell? And I get it pisses you off. Some companies do it right. Happy wearing a marathon. So if they're watching, they do it right. They'll send a message out months before. Hey, Boxing Day is coming up. Thanksgiving's coming up. We know what's this is the discount we're going to do. You're allowed to match them. And so we can all play by the same playbook. But, it bothers me to no end because manufacturers obviously have a much higher margin to erode. They can offer more of a discount, still make more money than I'm making. And it makes me look like a schmo.
Which
I don't need any help doing.
And then I would imagine the consumer is like looking at you and going,
"Say you know, you're ripping everybody off, huh?"
Yeah. Wow.
I got that this morning actually from somebody.
Oh, wow.
The email was, you're charging way too much for this watch. This guy has it for, and it wasn't a manufacturer, this guy has it for whatever it was.
Yeah.
I'm like, well, I'm not allowed to sell it that low. Either is he, but he obviously is not following the rules.
Yeah. And you're an authorized AD. I mean,
Yep. Try to do it all right.
Yeah.
I try to be a nice guy.
Good for you, man. Good for you. Okay, the next one is when people say they see a small watch and they say, oh, that's a lady's watch. Real men wear, this size. Oh. And it's like, what? Since when do we equate masculinity or achievement or anything with the size of your watch? I mean, that sounds like the most...
the size of something.
Sausage! Yeah, the most insecure thing I've ever heard.
Yep.
Have you ever seen Frank Sinatra wearing a watch? He wore these
very small ones.
Yeah.
Yeah, very small.
Ridiculous.
Absolutely, yeah.
I've got other examples, like Hemingway.
Yeah.
You know, it just, the list goes on and on. It's like, the comment doesn't annoy me, but what annoys me is there's people still with this limited
with
mindset.
Mentality.
Yeah, this mentality.
Right.
You know, if you like big watches, that's fine. But
Yeah.
It'll be interesting to go up to people with big watches and go,
What are you compensating for?
Yeah, what are you compensating? No, but you see, I wouldn't do that. That's not,
right.
You know, I don't. Is it parenting?
Might make a good video though.
Oh God, yeah, yeah. Slippery slope, you know.
Yeah. Let's see. My turn.
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely. So.
Hands that blend in with the dial. So.
Right.
Dress watches with black dials and highly polished silver hands, they kind of disappear. And that's almost, it's personal, but also as a seller, I can see it. When you have watches like that, they don't sell.
Yeah.
Or they get returned because people are like, I can't read the damn time.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, the so most important thing, right? Yeah.
Right, the most, right, sometimes, I think sometimes, the getting back to like odd size lugs, I think a lot of times, you know, these watch companies kind of forget that job number one,
yeah,
is tell the time. Because if it doesn't tell the time,
yeah,
you don't need it. You're not, you know, what are you selling? You're selling a bracelet.
Exactly.
So yeah. So I think that message kind of gets lost at times.
Absolutely. Is there any culprits that are just really?
There's an Orient. So there's an Orient Sun and Moon. It should be ET0T002B.
Yeah. By the way, I love the Sun and Moon. It's a great watch.
Sun and Moon is beautiful. That's the black dial Sun and Moon with silver hands. And it is just impossible to read. If you are not in like direct sunlight, it's a dog to read.
Do I remember correctly, the blue one had white hands?
Yeah, the blue one. I believe I think from Gen 2 to Gen 3, they switched it. You are correct. It had white hands eventually. And when I, not to plug my own brand, but when I did, you know, it's like when I did the Islanders, when I did dark colored dials, like the silver dial, the yellow dial and like blue dials, I went with white hands because I feel like it just pops. It's just so much easier to read. I think a lot of companies just get silver hands. Just everyone loves silver hands. And in the Orient situation, man, you can't read that dial for nothing.
Wow. Okay.
Go.
I was in 2 minds about adding this, but I have to be honest, it just annoys me. So I had to put it in. But when people use the word horology, they say they're not into watches, that they're into horology. And then I look at their Instagram and it's just watch after watch after watch after watch. And it's like, you're into watches. Like, yes, it's part horology. But if you were really into horology, right, you'd have an astrolabe, a water clock.
Right.
You'd have a Tompion mantle clock. You know, it'd
a
be
a clepsydra. Like, that's the word for a water clock. See, I even remember that.
Is it?
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
Nice.
Clepsydra, yes.
That must be Greek in origin.
I think so, yeah. I have a book all about time, and it starts, you know, all the clocks or whatever, and that's you know, that's one of the first timekeepers.
It's not misappropriation. What it is I love the hobby so much. I want it to be respected, and you know, like, people get it a bit pretentious with it. And it's just like, keep it real. You like watches.
Right, like a stamp collector or a coin collector, a philada, I can't even, it's funny, no clepsydra, because it's in my line, but you know, like a stamp collector, a coin collector, it's a PH something, again, someone will comment below what it is, but
a
very high-tech term for it.
Yeah, exactly, and I guess it's because also, if you really learn about horology, it actually might solve the problem of earlier people not appreciating the accuracy of the time, you know, because you start to understand that how watches and clocks evolved and how, you know, it changed the fate of nations.
Approximately 10 hours later.
But anyway, sorry, I'm going off on a tangent. But yeah, go on.
So that was three. So number four, this one bugs the crap out of me. No end-of-life indicator on a quartz watch. Because I own a bunch of quartz watches, I sure do, and they're all dead.
Yeah.
You know, my
who knows
Breitling,
when that was,
Right, my Breitling Aerospace right now is flashing the time, which I know that's an end-of-life indicator. I know the time, the battery is going, and so your, well, Seiko Solar is not a good example, but, you know, some of your Rondas, Edis, they tick at 4-second intervals.
Right.
But some of your watches, they just die.
They just die, yeah.
They just die, and that's not good for a quartz watch, you know, because maybe you don't have the battery on hand. I got to get to the jeweler. At least if it starts giving you an indication, hey, you got a month or 2 months, you can get the battery changed.
Yeah.
And it And that's the big fear of, like, a lot of times with quartz watches. Well, I hate having to get the battery changed every 2 years. Or I hate it dying on me. I look at it, I'm like, oh, I'm, you know, I missed my meeting because I was late or early or whatever. And that's one of the big things. If you had an end-of-life indicator, I think people would know, hey, it's time for a little maintenance, and you can get it changed. So.
Is that, I always presume that was just because it's they're just cheaper.
Yeah, it's movement based. It's a little it's a little bit of logic. It's a little bit of voltage comparing that has to go on inside inside the computer, the quartz computer. Mm-hmm. But it's not that difficult.
It's not that difficult
nowadays.
To do.
Especially nowadays, you know, I think that they should all have it. But a lot of these movements that maybe have been around for 20 years, they're still cranking them out, and it's not in the architecture.
Yeah, that's a good one. That is a good one. Okay, my last one of my personal pet peeves, and I know you're going to agree with me, is because we've talked about this before, but I just find women's watches really patronizing. All right, that's it, you know.
Okay,
they
fine.
Make they think that women, just because you're gonna like pink and diamonds, and it's just it's patronizing. Like my wife, most of my wife's watches are unisex or men's watches.
Yeah, mid-size, right? Men's mid-size.
So it's not really got to do with the size. It's got to, she likes a watch because it looks, or it matches her outfit, or
looks good.
It looks good, right?
Well, that's why women buy them to match their clothing, right? That's
yeah.
A big, men generally don't. Maybe you do. I don't.
Oh, I absolutely do. I totally admit it.
T-shirt and sweatpants today. It's sweatpants today. So
it's not all women. You know. Presuming they all think the same way, I think it's grossly kind of insulting.
You are actually, man, you hit on something that just happened literally half hour before I sat down to film this. So in the Islander lineup, I have a pink watch and a purple watch, as you just said. All people, men think pink and purple for women, and they're very great sellers. But my wife happened to see a green one that I sell.
Yeah.
And she said, and I would never market that to women. And she goes, I saw a green watch in your office. That's beautiful.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what?
Yeah.
Really? And then you just say that, and I'm like, damn, you're right. You're right on target. You're right on target.
Have you ever watched a film called Blow Up? It's from the 1966. It's Michelangelo Antonioni, and it has a very, very young Vanessa Redgrave in it, right? And this is... I think 66, I might be wrong, but this is mid-60s, the swinging 60s in London, right? She wears a Submariner, a men's, you know.
Yeah.
Submariner. She wore it over the cuff, which which I think was like a bit of a trend. But I remember distinctly at art school, because we had to study this movie, and I remember her wearing a watch, and I just thought, how cool is that?
Right.
It's so cool. I just thought... Right. If women back in the mid-60s were starting to wear, you know, and then there was the whole boyfriend watch trend.
Yeah.
Which is kind of insulting in its own, because it's like, oh, well, you're presuming that must be your man's watch. She's like, no, Jennifer Aniston likes to wear a gold Daytona.
Right, exactly.
Why is that the boyfriend watch? She probably bought that.
I get it.
So, anyway.
It's pigeonholing. That's
I don't like it. Yeah. This is probably my most negative video I've ever done. But anyway.
Well, it's supposed to be.
Yeah. So your last one, right?
My last one. So I kind of changed it up a bit, you know, as we were talking. Because it bothers the crap out of me. And it's in it's in your industry.
Oh, God.
And you're not guilty of it.
Okay.
So many review channels are pay to play.
Right.
Where if you want, and you see, it's the same thing, if you want to watch reviewed, but now from the manufacturer standpoint, now from the vendor standpoint, I have to give you the watch for free, or I actually have to compensate you for the review. And I'm just like, that takes away every bit of honesty in any journalism that there might be.
Yeah.
I have had people, they email and they say, love to review your watch on my channel, blah, 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 blah. And you say, okay, just let me know where to send it. I'll send you I'll give you a return label. You send it back to me. No, you don't understand. I keep the watch. I'm like, but that's not, how do you give an honest review if you're keeping it? Then I'm paying you. And I don't agree. That totally, You know, I always use the analogy, it's like a food critic walking into a restaurant, identifying themselves as a food critic and asking for the meal for free.
Right.
And how can you expect an honest review? And just as a seller, you know, I feel like it's a little window of dishonesty. It would be dishonest on my part, and it would be dishonest, it's also dishonest on, well, I guess if the reviewer discloses that it's a compensated review, that's fine.
Yeah, yeah.
It just, and that's good, but it just bothers me that, you know, if you want to get your stuff reviewed, you kind of got to pay for it.
Yeah.
No, I'm not.
I totally agree. I'm so glad you said that. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it bothers me.
Yeah, and that, but the problem is that I get into kind of difficulty when I love a brand so much. And you know, and
you talk too much.
Yeah,
You talk too much about it.
Yeah, and I talk too much about it. And then there was a rumor. I'm not going to mention the brand, but there was a rumor that I actually owned the brand. And it's like, no, I have no zero. I might know the CEO. I might know them. We've become friends or whatever. But it's not like I have no financial benefit if they sell a million or one. You
right.
know?
Well, if you read it on the internet.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Gotta be true. Yes.
I was put as the it's funny you should say that. I was put as the co-owner of a brand on Reddit. Not Reddit. My God. A Wikipedia.
Really?
Someone thought that was it. I was the co-owner. And in the info box on the right on Wikipedia had my name. And I'm like, what?
Yeah.
I don't own this brand. And I'm like, who writes this? And I learned that Wikipedia is just you can submit whatever you want.
Yeah.
Most things. You know, some articles you got to really be in like their core.
Yeah.
But I had to submit a correction. I have nothing to do with this brand.
That's crazy.
You know, maybe I sell it, but I don't own
it.
So
wow.
Yeah, be careful what you read about on the internet. It's not always
true. Yeah, absolutely. So I've got some. So that was.
That was my 10th
one.
I'm done.
Right. So yeah. I got some comments from, because I said in the last episode. Oh,
the people put them in the comments.
So this was from last episode, and I'll add a card thingy if you missed it. There you go. Anyway, so this is from Abe, and he said, my pet peeve is watches that I love and the lack of availability and the snobbery around the Rolex Submariner.
Huh. Excellent.
Yeah, absolutely.
Excellent.
Do you think there's snobbery around the Submariner?
Well, I hate saying this, but I own a sub. I feel like everyone owns
one.
Clearly, everyone does not own one. That's you know, that's hyperbole. But the snobbery around it, I don't know. Maybe the new ones, because you got to pay $15,000 to get an $8,000 watch.
Absolutely.
Maybe that's snobbery. Look at me, kind of thing.
I know homage watches obviously annoy a lot of people.
Right.
Anyway, okay, so next one. I got one from Mikey. I think the main one is trying to find the perfect watch. You always get something so close, but...
Doesn't exist.
Yeah, it doesn't. It doesn't exist. But there's always something missing. I like the idea of having one watch that works for everything, but I can't find one watch. That's an excellent one. Yeah. It doesn't exist. That's why...
That's the human... But that's the human condition.
Yeah, that's why we collect.
Yeah. Right, exactly. There are people that own just one watch and they don't care.
Yeah, I kind of admire that, you know.
My wife's got 150 pairs of shoes. It's because one's never enough.
Fair enough.
I don't own that many.
Yeah, fair enough. Okay, this is from Tycho. Mid and high-end watches that still use aluminium inserts instead of ceramic. Looking at you, Tudor. Mm. Mm-hmm. Fair enough. Yeah, Tudor level, come on, yeah.
I
agree. AR coating on the outside of sapphire glass, it nullifies.
Looking at you, Damasco.
Yeah, it nullifies the whole benefit of having sapphire crystals. Yeah, because it wears off.
Yeah, the insert thing is very interesting. You know, a lot of these high end companies to do ceramic right, they do it themselves, and Rolex took that capability in house to make their own ceramic. Very few, if any, companies make red ceramic inserts because it's very difficult, extremely difficult to get the chemistry right.
Is that just the pigment or
it has something to do with the pigment, also something to do with Rojas, which is reduction of hazardous substances. Not allowed to use a lot of the chemicals anymore that would normally turn ceramics red. To dye them.
Fascinating.
So a lot of the reds that you see and some of the reds that I sell are actually plated. It's a red plate. rather than a red ceramic.
Yeah, fascinating.
Carry on.
Okay, this is from Watch the Time. It says, people who hate on quartz.
I agree. Like, we just talked about end-of-life indicators, and yeah, you gotta, like, hey, I own quartz.
Yeah. I think, you know what, one comment I have seen, and I really irritates me, is oh, quartz, that's not real horology. As if horology is like a Jedi force, you know, some, you know, like, this is more horology than that. No.
Right.
Doesn't work like that.
Like, you know, then anyone says that, pick up, what is it, Shellman? Those really fine, is it, I think I have the name right. You're looking at me like I have 10 heads.
Yeah. Shellman.
I think it's Shellman. I'm looking at a computer.
Okay.
I'll have to look at it. I got the wrong name right. Shell something. And extremely high-end quartz watches.
Right.
Like, beautiful dials. Yeah.
Well, I think actually, I mean, the Grand Seiko kind of disproves that, really.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Absolutely.
Anthony says, annoying things. Faux patina. Yeah, I get that. Mm. Yeah, that's fine. Thick watches. I understand.
Okay. I get it.
Non-tool watches that are bigger than 40 millimeters.
Non-tool watches bigger than 40 millimeters. I don't know. Sometimes people just want a bigger watch.
You know what? I get criticized for my Navi timer because, you know, I've got minuscule wrists, right? But certain watches are supposed to be big. Oh, this is a good one. Cyclops on the outside instead of being behind the glass. So, you know that little layer of gunk around Cyclops?
Right at the
yeah,
seam.
Yeah. God, drives me nuts. Yeah. Absolutely.
Dead skin cells, soap, all that other crap that gets stuck there. Nasty.
Whoa. Yeah. This is Giacomo from Into the Limelight. Great Italian channel. I'm hooked on all the Italian watch channels. They're great. They are really doing a better job. There's a lot of passion. Anyway. He says, well, first of all, he was commenting on my worst use of the word minchia in about two of my... I'm not going to explain what that means, but pet peeve, wordy nonsense on some dials. Oh, yeah, and saying things like 1,800 meters instead of, you know, 43, blah, 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 blah. Yeah.
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 Yep.
Wordy dials, yeah.
Yeah, I'm with you.
Oh, my God, this person wrote a novel. My God, I don't even know where to start. No, I'll just pick out the ones in capital letters that he's put in capitals.
There you go, because those are the ones that are being shouted at you.
No, trailed lugs.
Yeah.
It's
not a big
that's
one.
More preference,
I'm not really,
though, isn't it?
That's pretty exactly. Some people don't like the look of drilled lugs.
Yeah, it ruins the kind of sleek.
The aesthetic.
Oh wait, sorry, I didn't say who that was. That was Marco, by the way. So thank you, Marco. Brookman says, being able to hear or feel the automatic watch work.
Yeah, well, that's, you know, that's your unidirectional winding Miotis.
Yeah.
That's your, also your Bambino is kind of noisy. And your Valjoo 7750 is a uni
rotor. Absolutely.
If you hit it the right way, it'll...
Yeah, and...
starts taking
it
off.
It feels like your wrist is moving. It'll actually move.
Well, it's a gyroscopic action. Yeah. So what it
absolutely.
Is.
Absolutely. I think that's probably more with people who have been used to high-end, and then suddenly they buy an SKX, and they're like, what is this? Do you know what I mean?
Right. What is the sound? What is this grinding
what
here?
Is... Andrew says, vanilla dive watches. Worse still, expensive vanilla dive watches. Yawn in capital letters.
What's a vanilla dive watch?
I think what he's referring to, I mean, he wrote quite a long...
Like, just like your standard...
Yeah, I think it's the derivative...
The Submariner copy?
Yeah, the derivative designs of everyone. Yeah, everything's a Submariner. Yeah, and then the problem is you do the opposite. You do an Aquis, right? And then people hate the lugs, or they hate this, or they
right,
hate...
Right, it's, oh, why do you do this? Right, yeah. Yeah.
Right. Rhino Fishing, that's probably not his real name. Says pet peeve, regular mineral crystal, why not at least hardened mineral or even acrylic? Any thoughts?
Well, my thought, and this is totally unfounded, so don't say it's
all
fact,
right.
Every mineral crystal is hardened,
right?
That's my opinion. I don't think people really do anything different.
Yeah.
What bothers me and when people say sapphire-coated mineral crystal.
Right. Yeah.
What the F is sapphire-coated mineral crystal? you atomize sapphire and you deposit it on the crystal. Sounds like it would have been cheaper just to make a sapphire crystal from the beginning. So I don't understand what that is. I do know that brands still use acrylic instead of using mineral or sapphire on purpose because they like the warmth. You know, vis-a-vis your, you know, the watch you're wearing today. You know, it is like the warmth of it, and you can always buff the scratch down and stuff. I don't know. I'm not. I sell a Junkers and a Zeppelin watch. Well, Junkers is gone. Zeppelin watch that has acrylic crystal, and I like to tell people, you look at it funny, it scratches.
Yeah.
You know, it really. You knock it on a plastic table, it's going to scratch. Yeah.
This is from Richard. He says, large watches with tiny lug widths. I totally get that. And actually, that was my only real negative about the Squally I just reviewed. It's my favorite watch, but I do think the lugs are too big. And and also when Squally didn't do this, but when people don't taper the strap, and so it's big all the way around, and it's a bit
so I got like a box cutter, a square
yeah, it's
cutter.
A bit unrefined,
so like a 20x20.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, Joseph says, my only pet peeve is that I don't have a wallet big enough to buy more watches. Yes. Yeah, so. Yeah, absolutely.
That's a universal truth.
Oh, we have a lady. Well, I presume she's a lady. Ashley, pet peeve, watches sold to a specific gender. Right, here we go.
Oh, I'll get that. Perfect.
Yeah, yeah.
Sounds familiar.
She goes on to say, they should simply be classified by case diameter, weight, and so on. Most so-called women's watches are boring dress pieces anyway. And if you want something fresh, adventurous, or athletic, you have to look at the men's models. Yes! Nice.
Right on.
Nice.
Right on, 100%.
Thank you very much, Ashley. Annoying things, increasing Seiko prices. Yeah, we've talked about that.
You know, I could talk forever about that. That is, it's, they're not increasing prices. They aren't.
Approximately 10 hours later.
They are just chopping out so much gray market that the watches are now selling for what the sticker on the box is. And that drives people bananas. Mm. The SNK 809 is supposed to be a $185 watch. That is the sticker on the box. Mm. But due to gray market, it sold for as low as $50.
Right, right.
So that's a whole nother, maybe a whole nother video.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. That was Gerardo, by the way, so thank you. Next we have Scratch Raptor. Obviously not his name. Oh, every time you have love at first sight, what seems to be a perfect watch, it ends up being too large of a case diameter. I was psyched when I saw the Black Bay Black, oh God. Mm-hmm. The alliteration kills me. I was psyched when I saw the Black Bay Bronze and was so let down by the 43 millimeters. Yeah.
Sure.
You know, that's the thing is that when I used to be quite a bigger chap, right? I used to wear big watches because I was just bigger, and I could never find the watches I wanted. Well, was too small, and now after I lost weight and became skinnier, all the watches I want now are way too big.
Right.
You know, so it's you can't really please. You know.
Can't get everybody.
Actually, I think what Yema do by having their Superman in two sizes, they've got 39mm, 41. I think that's, but it's expensive to way to go.
Yeah, to maintain, you know, two SKUs.
Yeah. So this is from Dalton. Luxury watches with laughable water resistance. Yeah. Hard to save up for a grail like a Reverso and then have to be conscious about the weather outside.
Yeah, or if you could wash your hands with it.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. At 60 plus, difficult to read dials and sub-dials. Yeah.
Sure.
I will never buy or wear 36mm or smaller watch. I don't believe they are coming back. In quotes. they are niche product for vintage watch enthusiasts. I kind of disagree with that.
History repeats itself.
It's all cyclical, isn't it?
Everything comes back. You'll be wearing old belt bottoms.
Yeah, oh God. No, don't bring those back. They're ghastly. Water-resistant classifications, except for ISO ratings, they're completely meaningless, if not outright deceptive. Yeah.
They are just deceptive.
Yeah.
That's correct.
Because it's not 100 meters, is it? Right, it just means you can wash up.
well, they say 100 meters is a snorkeling watch.
Snorkeling, right.
Yeah, it's a snorkel watch.
Yeah. Desk divers, the recreational divers who at least get their watches wet, arguing the merits of dive watches rated beyond 200 meters and helium escape valves. They are arguing how angels can dance on the head of a pin, in quotes. I've never...
Is that a saying?
I presume so.
That is not a saying I am using.
me neither. Since those are issues of legitimate concern only to one of a tiny minority or of real saturation divers. Yeah, that's absolutely true.
That's absolutely
true. And his last one is Seiko needs to offer adult size Mickey Mouse watches again.
Oh, I don't totally disagree with that.
Yeah.
That would be nice. That would be nice, yeah. Although I imagine that license probably too expensive for them at this point.
Most likely, yeah. Oh, yes. Yeah, I didn't even think of that.
Oh, yeah, 100, yeah.
Yeah.
So it's all about the Benjamins.
Yeah, well, nice. I'll put in the
track. Me going like this.
Yeah. Nice. I feel a lot better now.
You feel good now? You feel cleansed?
Yeah. You guys do add yours in the comments. And don't forget to subscribe to Marc. And I have to say a massive thank you to Marc. He's actually sponsoring this series. We will do this again. I hope next.
Yeah. Where are we? Yeah. I guess it'll be 2021.
2021.
Huh?
That's ridiculous.
Holy moly.
Yeah. And this is episode 7, I think. 6 or 7.
What? That I've been on?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's 7.
It's got to be like, no.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. Anyway, thank you so much, man.
Thank you for having me.
Do subscribe to Marc's channel. I'll leave a link in the description. What else? I haven't even thought what we're going to do.
What we're going to do for the next one.
We'll talk about it.
Yeah, no problem.
Anyway, guys, thank you so much for watching. Please don't forget to like this video if you enjoyed it, found it useful. And as always, we will catch you in the next one. Okay, ciao.